gives me repose. Beside restful waters, he leads me. He refreshes my soul. He guides me in a right path for his name's sake. Even though I walk in the dark valley, I fear no evil, for you are at my side. With your rod and your staff that give me courage. You spread the table before me in the sight of my foes. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Only goodness and kindness follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord for years to come.
A reading from the book of Revelation. I saw a new heaven and a new earth. The former heaven and the former earth had passed away, and the sea was no more. I also saw a holy city, a new Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. I heard a loud voice from the throne saying, "Behold, God's dwelling is with the human race. He will deal with them, and they will be his people. And God himself will always be with them as their God. He will wipe away every tear from their eyes, and there will be no more death or mourning, wailing or pain, for the old order has passed away." The one who sat on the throne said, "Behold, I make all things new. I am the Alpha and the Omega, the beginning and the end. To the thirsty, I will give a gift from the spring of life-giving water. The victor will inherit these gifts, and I shall be their God, and he will be my son." The word of the Lord.
Hallelujah,
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
A reading from the Holy Gospel according to Matthew.
Glory to you, O
Lord. John the Baptist appeared, preaching in the desert of Judea and saying, "Repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand." It was of him that the prophet Isaiah had spoken when he said, "A voice of one crying out in the desert, 'Prepare the way of the Lord, make straight his paths.'" John wore clothing made of camel's hair and had a leather belt around his waist. His food was locusts and wild honey. At that time, Jerusalem, all Judea, and the whole region around the Jordan were going out to him and were being baptized by him in the Jordan River as they acknowledged their sins. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. Alleluia, alleluia, alleluia.
My fellow Christians, some years ago, I presided and gave the homily at the funeral of a parishioner. After the funeral mass, a senior member of the parish thanked me for my kind words about the deceased. Then she added, "I hope you say nice things like that about me at my funeral." I replied, "Bonnie, if it falls to me to preside and give the homily at your funeral, I will tell the truth." To my surprise, Bonnie responded with a rather stern frown. It was obvious that she was not pleased with my reply. We, all of us here today, face a somewhat similar situation. If we tell the truth about John Koelsch, Father John Koelsch, will anybody believe us? I first came to know Father John by report. I was a new and young seminarian at Mount Angel Seminary. Two of my fellow Idaho students were Gary Driscoll and Dave Thomas, both natives of Moscow and St. Mary's Parish, whose pastor at the time was Father John. Gary Driscoll, we now know as Abbot Jeremy of Mount Angel Abbey. Dave Thomas is Father Paul, professor of canon law at Mount Angel Seminary. After the Christmas break, Gary and Dave joined other seminarians recounting their experiences in their home parishes. As good seminarians, both had reported in with their pastor and offered him assistance during the break. Father John graciously accepted their offer and gave them some chores to complete in the parish, and also asked them to assist and serve at the Christmas midnight mass. They were delighted to do so and reported in a timely manner to help with the preparations for the midnight mass. As midnight approached, Father John entered the sacristy and began to vest. Vesting in a green chasuble and a red stole worn over the chasuble. Gary and Dave were startled and confused, and with all due respect and decorum, inquired of Father John why he was not vesting in white or gold vestments. Father John calmed their confusion, replying, "Red and green, aren't these the Christmas colors?" Through the years, this report and commentary on it have been subjects of a number of liturgy classes at Mount Angel. I enjoyed a more personal encounter with Father John a few months after my ordination. In the fall, I was elected as the representative of the most junior group of priests to what was then called the Priest Senate, the forerunner of today's Presbyteral Council. I remember well the first time I attended a meeting of the Senate. It was at St. Paul's Student Center here in Boise. As was the custom at the time, the meeting began in the early evening, broke for the night, and then continued again the next morning. After the evening portion of the meeting, I was invited to join several other Senate members, among them Father John, to eats and drinks at a restaurant. During this gathering, Father John turned to me and said, "Jerry, there's something you need to understand about the Priest Senate and its role in the church. Think of the British House of Lords. It's the upper chamber of the British Parliament. The Lords meet with great ceremony, an ancient ritual, in a richly appointed chamber where they deliver eloquent and long speeches. However, the Lords have absolutely no power, no influence on legislation, and no one pays any attention to them. Such are the Priest Senate and its role in the diocese." At the time, I judged this to be a very cynical commentary. However, having served several terms on the Presbyteral Council over the years, I have grown in my appreciation of Father John's insight and wisdom. Having been ordained a priest in 1956, Father John was, at the time of his death, the longest-serving priest of the Diocese of Boise. It is true Father Sean Caulfield has been ordained longer than Father John, but Father Sean has served as a priest of the diocese only in the latter half of his years of priesthood. As Father John himself frequently commented, he and his brother priests of the time were educated and formed to be priests with one vision, understanding, theology of the church and a priesthood, and then called to serve most of their years as priests with quite a different vision, understanding, theology of church and priesthood. Or maybe we should say different visions, understandings, and theologies of church and priesthood. Thus, Father John was richly blessed with interesting and challenging times. And through it all, he did quite well. He and the parishes he served not only survived, but in many ways flourished. Father John brought to his ministry a certain expertise in liturgy. Well, maybe expertise is not quite the correct word. Possibly a more appropriate word would be flair. Yes, Father John had a certain flair for liturgy. Early on, he became a son of the Second Vatican Council, inspired, maybe not so much guided, by its constitution on the sacred liturgy. Father John was a true pioneer. Like the Starship Enterprise, he boldly took liturgy where no one had gone before. Father's third assignment as pastor was at St. Mary's Church in Moscow. Father John took seriously his pastoral ministry in that great city, even granting himself the title Patriarch of Moscow. And this was enhanced by his subsequent assignment in Rupert, which parish is under the patronage of one of the most beloved saints of the Eastern Church, St. Nicholas. So he became the great patriarch of the East. In his role as patriarch, Father John wrote and then used at Masses several of his own Eucharistic prayers. He reworked and rearranged the liturgy of the Easter Vigil, rearranging its very parts, as he said, in a more understandable and approachable order. Indeed, with pastoral concern for his people's ability and stamina to participate in the three liturgies of Holy Thursday, Good Friday, and Holy Saturday, he developed one single liturgy, taking and rearranging various parts of each of the liturgies of the Triduum, thus making it more convenient and possible, so he judged, for the faithful to participate in this one liturgy rather than three liturgies spread over 3 days. It all makes sense. so it seems. Father John was the inspiration and architect of both Our Lady of the Lake Church in McCall and St. Jude Church in Council, which churches, subsequent pastors, I now being among them, have both admired and cursed. Do you remember the doors of these two churches? With yellow tinted fiberglass encasing various circles? They were designed and indeed manufactured by Father John himself. He took great pride in these doors and years later installed one of them in the bathroom of his apartment in Sacred Heart here in Boise. The door did not exactly fit its frame, but that was of no consequence. And those of you who saw it, how could we forget his rearrangement of the altar at his last pastorate in St. Edward's Church in Twin Falls? He moved the altar down among the pews and then constructed a baldacchino over the altar. It's amazing what can be done with a garden gazebo and a can of gold spray paint, both available at Walmart. Father John delighted in theological discourse and debate and lamented that most of his brother priests were seemingly reluctant to engage in it. He frequently was, like his patron, a voice crying out in the wilderness. He regularly wrote letters to the editor, to America Magazine and other journals, debating with writers and offering commentary on the signs of the times. In this he earned a certain fame. Now, I do not remember the exact details, but I think this is the situation. It was during my first visit to the Holy Land. Because of a classmate, I was a guest for several weeks at the École Biblique, the French Dominican School of Biblical Studies in Jerusalem. And at the time, in resident and a professor at the École was Father Jerome Murphy O'Connor, an English Dominican and scripture scholar and author of some note. When I introduced myself to him as a priest of the Diocese of Boise, Idaho, Father remarked that for some reason he knew and was familiar with our diocese, although at the moment he could not recall why. And let's admit it, not everyone knows the Diocese of Boise in Idaho. A few days later, Father asked me if I knew a Father John Koelsch. I was surprised to hear this name, but replied that yes, he was a brother priest of my diocese. And then Father explained how several years previously, Father John had written him a letter commenting on one of his recently published articles or books. Father responded with a note to Father John thanking him for his comments. Well then, over the following years, Father received a number of letters from Father John, each 4 or 5 pages of single-spaced text, commenting on a wide variety of scriptural topics and controversies. Father Murphy O'Connor stated he was always unsure whether or how he should respond to this rather abundant communication. Many stories like this can and should be told and retold. Many of you, I'm sure, have similar stories of your experiences with Father John and his cats, his cars, the model trains, his innovative use of duct tape, his adventures in camping and traveling. Let the legends continue to be told and grow. But we'll have to do this at another time. Father John was a people's priest. The exercise of his flair for the liturgy, with all its quirkiness, was intended to bring the liturgy, its spirit and power into the real lives of his people. As pastor, he did not give much of his time and energy to administration. Rather, he devoted them to the service of the gospel and the people. He sought to have his people empowered in their faith and to enjoy being the church. Father John envisioned a new heaven and a new earth. Having studied in Rome, here in Idaho, Father John transformed the skills in Italian that he had acquired there into Spanish and became one of the first native priests of the diocese to engage in ministry to the Latino faithful. He was a great supporter and advocate of the Curcio movement in both English and Spanish. Later in his ministry, he was a faithful supporter of the evangelization retreats. All of this to strengthen and promote the faith and participation of the laity. Father John was a priest. He was kind, generous, as in the reading from the prophet Isaiah, from his own pocket, he frequently provided a table of rich foods and fine choice wines. He made annual visits to the seminary. He wanted to know the Idaho seminarians, and of course, he invited them out to a fine dinner. He promoted and called us a two-priestly fraternity and lamented how difficult we found it to be fraternal. The respect he enjoyed among his fellow priests was manifested in the numerous times he was elected to serve on both the Presbyteral Council and the Personnel Board. He was a gentle and compassionate confessor. Throughout his priestly service, Father John spurred us on to climb the mountain of the Lord. He invited us to see a new vision. He called us to the kingdom. Father John, our fervent prayer and hope for you today is that indeed the kingdom of heaven be at hand, and that you find the kingdom most delightful, even beyond your wildest imaginings.
Aware of God's presence among us, we now make our petitions known.
For our brother John, who served the church as a priest, that he may be given a place in the liturgy of heaven, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For those who have fallen asleep in the hope of rising again, that they may see God face to face, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For the family and friends of our brother John, that they may be consoled in their grief by the Lord, who wept at the death of his friend Lazarus, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer.
For all of us assembled here to worship in faith, that we may be gathered together again in God's kingdom, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, hear our prayer. God, our shelter, God, our strength, you listen in love to the cry of your people. Hear the prayers we offer for our departed brother and sisters. Cleanse them from their sins and grant them the fullness of redemption. We ask this through Christ our Lord. Amen.
O Lord of my heart, not be all those to me save that thou art. Thou be my best aught by day or by night, walking and sleeping, thy presence my light. Be thou my wing.
My brothers and sisters, that my sacrifice and yours may be acceptable to God, the Almighty Father. Grant, we pray, Almighty God, that through these holy mysteries, John, your servant and priest, may behold with clarity forever what he faithfully ministered here on earth, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And with your spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
Lift up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right.
It is truly right and just, our duty and our salvation, always and everywhere to give you thanks, Lord Holy Father, Almighty and Eternal God. In Jesus, the hope of the blessed resurrection has dawned, that those saddened by the certainty of dying might be consoled by the promise of immortality to come. Indeed, for your faithful, Lord, life is changed, not ended. And when this earthly dwelling turns to dust, an eternal dwelling is made ready for them in heaven. And so with angels and archangels, with thrones and dominions, and with all the host and powers of heaven, we sing the hymn of your glory as without end we now acclaim.
Holy, 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 Lord God of hosts, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest.
You are indeed holy, O Lord. And all you have created rightly gives you praise. For through your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, by the power and the working of the Holy Spirit, you give life to all things and make them holy, and you never cease to gather a people to yourself, so that from the rising of the sun to its setting, a pure sacrifice may be offered to your name. Therefore, O Lord, we humbly implore you, by the same Spirit, graciously make holy these gifts we have brought to you for consecration, that they may become the body and blood of your Son, our Lord Jesus Christ, at whose command we celebrate these mysteries. For on the night that he was betrayed, he himself took bread, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and eat of it, for this is my body which will be given up for you." In a similar way, when supper was ended, he took the chalice, and giving you thanks, he said the blessing, and gave the chalice to his disciples, saying, "Take this, all of you, and drink from it, for this is the chalice of my blood, the blood of the new and eternal covenant, which will be poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this in memory of me." The mystery of faith. We eat this bread and drink this cup. We proclaim your death, O Lord, until you come again. And therefore, O Lord, as we celebrate the memorial of the saving passion of your Son, his wondrous resurrection and ascension into heaven, and as we look forward to his second coming, we offer you in thanksgiving this holy and living sacrifice. Look, we pray, upon the oblation of your church, and recognizing the sacrificial victim by whose death you willed to reconcile us to yourself, grant that we who are nourished by the body and blood of your Son, and filled with his Holy Spirit, may become one body, one spirit in Christ. May he make of us an eternal offering to you, so that we may obtain an inheritance with your elect, especially with the most blessed Virgin Mary, Mother of God, with Saint Joseph, her spouse, with your blessed apostles, glorious martyrs, Saint John, each of our patron saints, and with all the saints on whose constant intercession in your presence we rely for unfailing help. May this sacrifice of our reconciliation, we pray, O Lord, advance the peace and the salvation of all the world. Be pleased to confirm in faith and charity your pilgrim church on earth, with your servant Francis our Pope, me your unworthy servant, the order of bishops, all the clergy, and the entire people you have gained for your own. And listen graciously to the prayers of this your family, whom you have summoned before you. In your compassion, O merciful Father, gather to yourself all your children scattered throughout the world. And remember your servant John, whom you have called from this world to yourself. Grant that he who is united with your Son in death like his may also be one with him in his resurrection, when from the earth he will raise up in the flesh those who have died, and transform our lowly body after the pattern of his own glorious body. To our departed brothers and sisters too, and to all who are pleasing to you at their passing from this life, give kind admittance to your kingdom. There we hope to enjoy forever the fullness of your glory, when you will wipe away every tear from our eyes. For seeing you, our God, as you are, we shall be like you for all the ages, and praise you without end, through Christ our Lord, through whom you bestow on the world all that is good. Through him, and with him, and in him, O God, almighty Father, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all glory and honor is yours, forever and ever. Amen, amen, amen. At the Savior's command, informed by divine teaching, we now dare to say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Deliver us, Lord, we pray, from every evil. Graciously grant peace in our days, that by the help of your mercy we may be always free from sin and safe from all distress, as we await the blessed hope in the coming of our Savior, Jesus Christ. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Lord Jesus Christ, who said to your apostles, "Peace I leave you, my peace I give you," look not on our sins, but on the faith of your church, and graciously grant her peace and unity in accordance with your will, who live and reign forever and ever.
Amen. Amen.
May the peace of our Lord be with you always.
And with your spirit. Let us offer each other a sign of peace.
Behold the Lamb of God. Behold him who takes away the sins of the world. Blessed are those called to the supper of the Lamb. Lord, I am not worthy that you should enter under my roof, but only say the word, and my soul shall be healed.
Resucitó.
Love. body.
Vanished are my fears now that has passed away. Resuscita, resuscita, resuscita. Gracias sean dadas al Padre que nos pasó a su reino donde se vive el amor. Kingdom, praise to God the kingdom, raised up to the kingdom, he shall live in resuscita, 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 alleluia, 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 resuscita.
Let us pray. Lord, hear the prayers of those you renew with the food of life at your holy table. By the power of this sacrifice, may Father John, your servant and priest, rejoice in your presence forever as he served you faithfully in the church. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
A word of thanks to all those who have helped with this liturgy. I want to thank our head of the worship department, Tish Thornton. Thank you for your good work. For our musicians, we're grateful for you. Deacons, thank you. Our newest ordained deacon is Adrian Lasco, and we're grateful for your presence. Last Saturday, he was ordained a deacon. To all of our brother priests, I'm sorry for you as you grieve the loss of a loved one. Father Boniface, thank you for taking such good care of Father John as you allowed him to house on your property for years. We're grateful for the ministry, the care, the pastoral care you've given him. Father Jerry, thank you for the homily. Where are you sitting now? Did Father Jerry leave? Oh, there you are. Thank you for your homily. It was good. It gave a snapshot of the man that anybody that knew him would identify with as a good priest and a character. He gave the definition for thinking outside the box when it comes to the Catholic Church. Matter of fact, the stories I heard when I first arrived here 5 years ago, that he wanted a convertible car. The car was not a convertible, so he just saw it off the top. He also wanted a car that had air conditioning. What he did is he, before air conditioning was big in cars, he'd hook up a couple fans with a huge block of ice and drove around with the wind of the fan over the ice of the block, and it cooled down the car. Many other things. I don't know what the square footage of his trailer, which he lived in for a while, was probably at best 300 square feet, which you can only live in about 2 square feet of it. It was packed. But on a serious note, think of the numbers of Eucharist that he attended and celebrated. How many times did he hold up at consecration the bread that turned into the body of Christ and the blood that was once wine in order to nurture God's people with God's grace as designed for the church. Now the Lord lifts him up, and he is consumed by love, which is eternal, we trust, and that he will again be reunited with his communities as he once was. How blessed we are to have known him, how blessed we are to have him as a brother who lives on forever. Let's call upon him in need. Let's have the final commendation now. Before we go our separate ways, let us take leave of our brother John. May our farewell express our affection for him. May it ease our sadness and strengthen our hope. One day we shall joyfully greet him again when the love of Christ, which conquers all things, destroys even death itself.
Glorious holy face.
and may your grace and love enfold him evermore, so he may dwell in paradise at last. Receive his soul and let eternal light shine, eternal light forever on his soul. So he may be forever in your dwelling place and be at rest in a peace on until we meet him there.
To you, O Lord, we commend the soul of John, your servant. In the sight of this world, he is now dead. In your sight, may he live forever. Forgive whatever sins he has committed through human weakness, and in your goodness, grant him everlasting peace. And we ask this through Christ our Lord.
Amen. Amen.
In peace, let us take our brother to his place of rest.
John, may the angels lead you into paradise. May the martyrs come to welcome you and take you to the holy city, new and eternal Jerusalem.
Praise the very Lord of glory, who is risen up today. Alleluia, alleluia, blessed Jesus, maker's right.